friends, and welcome to the 7th John F. Charles Lecture, given this year by Professor Jeremy McInerney of the University of Pennsylvania. I want to say a few things about the lectureship, and my colleague Professor Leslie Day will introduce Professor McInerney. This event has been generously funded by Bruce Baker, who earned his AB from Wabash in 1965, and was honored with an LHD, an honorary degree, in 2007. Dr. Baker established the Charles Lecture in honor of his teacher, John F. Charles, Lafayette Professor of Greek and History at Wabash from 1940 to 1979. I'm pleased that we are able to have the lecture's benefactor, Dr. Baker, with us tonight. We are most grateful for, and indeed in awe of, his exceptional loyalty to Wabash. Please join me in acknowledging Bruce and thanking him for his loving support of this talk. Since this lectureship honors the late Professor Charles, I'd like to say a few things about John, or as everyone knew him, Jack. In the program, you can find the citation that was read when Jack was granted an honorary degree from Wabash, but here's a bit more color. His classroom demeanor drew in flocks of students, and in those settings, he had a special knack for turning phrases. Celts or Gauls to Jack were not Central European tribesmen, but, quote, card-carrying barbarians. Early humans included caveman Ugg. And when the Grand Mufti of Syria visited campus in the 1960s, Jack asked an important question. If a pontiff pontificates, does a mufti mufticate? These bon mots capture some of Jack Charles's wit, but I want to try to render a more textured portrait of his professorial character. And so, just as Dr. Charles would have advised, I headed straight to the primary sources. Archivist Beth Swift, as always, had just the right document. A pamphlet that Professor Charles penned, which is entitled Good Form in Research Papers. It contains plenty of sage advice and prompts for reflection. To the student who asks, why are there so many rules? Professor Charles responds, most of the rules are either matters of common sense or conventions that everyone follows to avoid confusion and misunderstanding. It's a little like traffic regulations. It doesn't really make any difference in principle whether you stop on red or green or drive on the right or left side of the street, as long as everyone else does the same. Later in the document, under section B, rules, which is entitled Rules Having to Do with Giving the Reader Your Evidence, Jack's wit and forthrightness reappear. He says, this is usually called documentation and provokes more complaints among students than any other aspect of paper writing. They often ask plaintively, does this paper have to have footnotes? As if footnotes were a kind of seasoning to be sprinkled over a paper to give it flavor. As impressive as the quality of Jack's teaching was, its range. In addition to history, Greek, Latin, and occasionally Egyptian hieroglyphs, he took on Spanish once when a staffing problem arose in the 1970s. And when pressed into duty in the 1940s during the V-12 program for sailors, Professor Charles offered a course on naval strategy, using the Battle of Salamis between the Greeks and the Persians in 480 BCE as a prominent component of the syllabus. Unclear how that served us in World War II, but we know who won. A habitual pipe smoker, inveterate haunter of the Round Table in the Scarlet Inn, and wearer of leather patches on the elbows of his blazers, Jack was, in appearance, straight from professorial central casting. His look, his command of history, his gift for capturing young men's imaginations and for exciting their intellects, all of these characteristics made Jack Charles a defining figure in so many Wally's careers. Indeed, one alumnus who reflected on this professor's impact was prompted to say, quote, "Dr. Charles, had you not existed, your students would have had to invent you." Jack Charles, some little giant. Now, tonight's event isn't a one-off lecture, but the highlight of a multi-day stay on campus by a prominent, indeed preeminent, scholar of the pre-modern world. In fact, the idea for the Charles lecture was inspired by one of Bruce Baker's undergraduate experiences when the eminent historian Sir Stephen Runciman and the renowned archaeologist George Milanos each visited the college for several days. In keeping with that model, we have kept this year's lecturer, Dr. McInerney, very busy over the last couple of days as he has visited classes, run workshops, dined with students and faculty, and now delivers the lecture itself. I'm confident that you all, just like the students whom he has enthralled in his time on campus, will relish Professor McInerney's talent for thinking about the ancient world not as an intellectual plaything, but as a lived experience that triggers reflection about our own world. I'll now turn the lectern over to my colleague, Professor Leslie Day, as she introduces this year's Jack Charles lecturer.
Very tough act to follow. I was asked to introduce tonight's speaker because I have simply known him longer than anybody else. he first came to the Kabusi excavations under my direction as a trench supervisor in 1989. He spent two seasons there, and he made himself absolutely memorable. For his abundant energy and enthusiasm, even when he was asked to dig bedrock, for his intellectual insightfulness, and for his wicked sense of humor. These are all traits which have served him well in his career at the University of Pennsylvania, where currently he is chair of the department, and the Davidson Kennedy Professor of Classical Studies. And many of you who've already heard him will understand why he got where he has gone. He is a brilliant teacher. He's won teaching awards, and he even does those teaching company videos, you know, the great courses. He's one of the lecturers for that, which is a really hard honor. He has been a brilliant teacher as well as a great mentor for his students, and he is also a renowned scholar. He does, as Jeremy indicated, not the usual kind of thing. You won't find him doing yet another riff on Thucydides or 5th century Athens or Herodotus. But in fact, what he's doing is very interesting. He's exploring the margins of the Greek world. He's expanding our knowledge and deepening our knowledge of ancient Greek culture and ancient Greek history. I think that Jack Charles would just have been fascinated by what he's doing. He would also have been very critical of it, because he didn't take these things lightly. But Jeremy has been working, he started out working at the area of focus, which you've all heard of. Which is the area around Delphi, which you probably have heard of. And he did a study of this using archaeological material and documentary material to try to understand what was going on in some of these places that were not Athens and Sparta and all the usual kinds of places. And he came up with really interesting ideas about how the Phocians constructed their own identity. He moved on to the sacred cows of the Greek world, and I mean that literally. He did a book called The Cattle of the Sun, and he explored the role that cattle played in Greek society, religion, and the economy. So tonight, he's going to move on to something even more different when he's going to talk about Alexander the Great and the Silk Road. So I give you Professor McInerney.
See, what you don't realize is that when Leslie said that
She had made me dig bedrock. She was actually telling me the literal truth because I excavated a square at Kabusi, 5 by 5 meters, and it was the only purely sterile square in the history of Minoan archaeology. I got to 5 by 5 meters of bedrock with not one single freaking shirt. So thank you. Thank you for that warm introduction. Waiting 25 years to get to I want to say thank you very much to the Classics Department. I've never been to Wabash before, but I feel that there's a nice developing relationship here. I've read Bronwyn Wickheiser's work a great deal because she works in very similar areas to me. I've known Joe and Leslie for more years than we both like to remember. 2 years ago, while I was in Athens, I had to give a report at the American School on an epigram found up at Arta. And I was really embarrassed when I was assigned this topic for the report because I'd been a student there 25 years earlier and I thought I remembered most of the important things. And when I was told to do this report, I actually had to stop and think, I don't know what the polyandrion at Arta is. And I found out that in fact it had been discovered since I had been a student there. It was a new discovery. And the person who of course wrote the best piece on it was Joe Day. And I met Jeremy only about a year or so, Jeremy Hartnett, about, that's really weird. It's very difficult to be writing to someone in emails who has the same name as you. You know, it's weird to write Dear Jeremy when your name is Jeremy. It feels somehow narcissistic. Anyway, we were on an NEH panel together, and even more recently, my colleague, Sheila Murnahan, has been here to Wabash. And so I'm hoping we can actually nurture this relationship a little bit more. And for those of you who are undergraduates here who might be thinking about graduate school in classics or ancient history, my advice is don't. Okay, there's no money to be made in it. But if you want to drop into Philadelphia sometime and say hello, you're always welcome to the University of Pennsylvania. I also want to say thank you very much to Bruce Baker, whose extraordinary generosity is really integral to the health of this department. When I came, I actually thought Wabash was going to be a much bigger college. And so to find that this is a small college of 900 men, but with such a vital interest in the life of the mind, to me is testament to a kind of vigor here. And that relies in a real and positive sense on three things. It relies on having patrons with generosity who understand the mission of a school like this. It relies on having a good institutional memory of men like Jack Charles, who clearly was one of those fantastic mentors who changed the lives of many, many young men. And it relies on having a dynamic and committed faculty right now. And because you've got those three things, you are in a great, great shape. And I'm saying this, even though it's in a sense fairly obvious, because if you're in this, you may not recognize it, but you will look back on this as a golden period in Wabash's history. And I'm glad that we're all getting to enjoy this together right now. All right, that's enough of the thanks. I want to get into the business of what we're actually doing this evening. Over the last generation, the Silk Route has begun to attract renewed attention. It's a trade network that quite literally spans the Eurasian continents, linking at times at least two great empires, the Romans and the Chinese. The Silk Route reminds us that the scale of human history can range from a vast complex of nodes and links between kingdoms, and at one end, and at the other end, it can be as simple as one person and a bunch of camels crossing the desert. Lonely figure traveling. No map can really do it justice. Sorry, I'm just playing with the technology here, trying to get it to a size that I can read. No map can really do it justice, since it was never one single road or route, although this map does emphasize the broadly east-west orientation of the route, extending from Japan in the east to the Mediterranean world in the west. It's a good illustration of what recent historical approaches in the work of Jared Diamond and Cyprian Broodbank, and frankly, Stephen Murillo, I would add to that list, of world historians has shown us, namely, that the Eurasian continent, despite mountains and the human construct of east and west, has natural lines of communication and connectivity. Across much of this continent, of this continental mass, excuse me, there is a web of connections, routes crossing deserts, occasionally using waterways, but always allowing the movement of goods and people over quite astonishing distances. We know that as a network, it witnessed a trade in precious objects, like, of course, the silk for which it is named, as well as emeralds and spices. And of course, the movement of such goods does not require the same merchant to travel all the way from, for example, China to Antioch. Marco Polo was the exception, not the rule, but the goods do pass along this route. Other less tangible goods than the emerald traded over thousands of kilometers were the ideas and religious beliefs, such as Buddhism, that traveled along the route. Here, for example, in the caves of the 100 Buddhas outside Dunhuang in western China, princes from various regions along the Silk Route are shown in mourning after Sakyamuni has entered Nirvana. A little like the Abhidhamma release from Persepolis, this uses quite distinct markers of dress and coiffure, and here even skin color, to suggest distinct ethnic groups, whose variety attests to the universal appeal of the Buddha. Even diseases, another silent and invisible commodity that passed from east to west or from west to east along routes established by, passed along these routes, established by caravans and merchants. In 2010, so only a few years ago, researchers found evidence for a genetic link between sufferers of a disease called Behçet's syndrome found in both Japan and Turkey. The disease was genetically linked across that span. Populations, and I'm now quoting the researchers, separated by thousands of miles but tied together by the ancient trading route, hence the name Silk Road disease. I am not going to show you the slide. You should be thankful, it's really hideous. It's recently become clear that even before we speak of the Silk Road or Silk Routes, in the plural, of this network, there were goods, artistic motifs, and people too, moving across Central Asia. The so-called international or Eurasian animal style turns up in Bulgaria and in the Black Sea region. And it turns up in northern China. Artists shared motifs and spoke, as it were, a common language. We now even have some sense of the actual people who moved between what we would later call Europe and Asia. My colleague at the University of Pennsylvania, Victor Mayer, has worked on the mummies of the Tarim Basin. And these mummies point to physical connections between East and West going back into the second millennium BC. Some have argued that bronze metallurgy and chariot warfare entered China from the West and have used later descriptions in Pliny the Elder, who describes embassies coming from China, whose delegates were taller than the Romans, than the average Roman, had flaxen hair and blue eyes. Imagine a Roman classifying me as a Chinese ambassador. Tells you something interesting. What's really interesting, though, is that Pliny says that, quote, the rest of the information given by these ambassadors about the Chinese was the same as what the Romans had learned from their merchants. Now, we'll come back to the question of Roman trade shortly, but the key point I wish to make here is that when I speak of the Silk Road as a network, I'm distinguishing between these earlier connections formed by the movement of peoples and the associations between various nomadic groups, low levels of movement of goods, and I'm talking rather about a semi-formal or a developed network of systematic connections. That's going to be the real Silk Route. These systematic connections favoured and encouraged, if not controlled, directly by large imperial states, at one end Rome and at the other China. These are different types of trade, and they involve different definitions of empire. The overt reason for these networks was to facilitate trade over long distances, usually the trade of precious goods rather than of staples, because the Silk Route was primarily, first and foremost, not a maritime network. And so it was unlikely to involve bulky items such as grain, wine, or oil, heavy, big items that go into amphorae. So as well as emphasizing the scale of trade, I also wish to emphasize the quality of this trade. In short, what type of goods were transported and how did the differences between the trade in staples, wine, oil, flour, grain, and luxury goods modify the development of the Silk Route. We'll come to that more in a moment. That said, recent paleobotanical studies have in fact demonstrated the continuous exchange of seeds and species of crops throughout this critical area, as you can see here. But this is probably a byproduct of the movement of caravans rather than the deliberate trade in grains from one region to another. There's really no reason in the ancient world to move tons of grain from Turkmenistan to Kyrgyzstan. It just doesn't make sense. So despite these fellow travelers, as it were, these new species, the Silk Route is a network unlike the Mediterranean or the Indian Ocean networks that existed before it and alongside it. The high cost of land transport favored small, high-value goods moving along the Silk Route. Goods such as spices, like cinnamon, coming from Vietnam, but traded across the entire Silk Road network. Gems, such as emeralds, whose value makes them worth trading over long distances because they can be traded in small amounts. Imagine the amount of olive oil or wine you would need to match the value of that handful of emeralds. This is much more highly transportable. Glass, such as this Persian goblet that made its way to Nara in Japan, an excellent example of how distance can enhance the trade value of a precious item, emphasizing its rarity. Or, of course, the silk, for which the trade route is actually named. Even the very coins that paid for these goods themselves became, in a sense, exotic items because they'd come from a long way away. Imagine being in Japan or in central China or western China and finding this coin of Justinian. A byproduct of this was exoticism, the value added by the sheer distance the goods traveled from their place of origin. The difference between the Mediterranean network and the Silk Road can be expressed this way. You can ship a full cargo of Italian wine to France by boat more cheaply than you can send it 60 miles inland. Water provides the lifeblood for moving bulky staple items in amphorae and freight boats around the Mediterranean. But an emerald found in 1997 in a Gallo-Roman grave in France was shown by isotope analysis to have originated in the Swat Valley in Afghanistan. So it moves across a vastly greater area, a journey made possible by the Silk Route, but probably not a journey made by many amphorae. In the first millennium AD, both superpowers at either end, Rome and China, were aware of the importance of the route, but interestingly, the geographical texts produced by both the Romans and the Chinese deal with the intermediate stages, but not what lies at the far end. The Romans did not have a clear idea of China, the Chinese didn't have a clear idea of Rome. A 3rd century Chinese geographic text, composed between 239 and 265 of the Common Era by Yu Huan, contained a lengthy section entitled The Peoples of the West, in which are found chapters dealing with cities at the very western edge of the Chinese world. For example, section 24 describes the kingdom of northern Wuyi, Bei Wuyi, which is identified with Kujan or Alexandria Eskate at the top of the map, farthest Alexandria, modern Kujan or, lamentably in some recent years, Leninabad, south of Tashkent and northeast of Samarkand. In the early 2nd century AD, this city in the region it controlled, Dai Yuan, was a separate state that sent tribute and offerings to China, along with Kashgar and Yarkand. But Chinese geography didn't go any further west. The region I'm showing you there is essentially Afghanistan. So Chinese geography extended to the west of China, then across the Hindu Kush and down into what is today Afghanistan, but they didn't have a clear conception of what lay further to the west. The Romans, coming from the other end of the route, had the same kind of block. In the 1st century AD, Isidore of Carax produced a work called the Parthian Stations, stations being spots along the route, giving brief descriptions of the places on the route from Antioch on the Mediterranean coast as far as Afghanistan. So again, Roman knowledge goes to Afghanistan from the west, and Chinese knowledge goes to Afghanistan from the east, but they don't go further than that. Neither side had a clear knowledge of the other, and the existence of independent states in between, particularly the Parthians and the kingdom of Khotan, made any sustained direct contact unlikely. In fact, according to the Chinese Hu Hanshu, a text which records information about the Western world from the Chinese point of view, an ambassador named Khanum was dissuaded from traveling to the eastern provinces of the Roman Empire, called Tatsin, by the Parthians. In the text it says, the Anxi, the Parthians, wished to carry on trade with the people of Tatsin, Rome, in Chinese silks, and it's for this reason that they were cut off, Tatsin, Rome was cut off, from direct communication with China. The middleman wanted to be able to keep his cut. For their part, the Romans were interested in the location, less interested in the location of China, and more in the actual silk, the product, that reached them from so far away. This, of course, would be bemoaned by Roman moralists, who were always looking for something to complain about. They decried the addiction of Roman women to a fabric that revealed as much as it concealed. In Pliny's words, it's like a wet t-shirt competition. In Pliny's words, ut denudet feminas vestis, that it might denude women in their clothing, because silk was sheer. Even worse was the idea of virile Roman men defiling themselves with such eastern effeminacy. Tacitus tells us that under Tiberius, the Senate passed legislation, de vesti sedica viros foederet, that men should not befoul themselves with Chinese garments. Sedica was adopted from the Greek to mean Chinese things, and specifically silk. I find it interesting, actually, we use China to mean porcelain, the Romans used China to mean silk. It's whatever you get from that place. Aside from the Romans' predilection for both indulging in luxury and lamenting it, there were good reasons for worrying about this trade. With the development of the sustained exploitation of the monsoon winds and weather patterns, Roman trade by sea to India grew apace from the first century on, and the Romans worried that there was a distinct imbalance in their trade. Pliny, in the Natural History, says, and by the lowest reckoning, India, China, and the Arabian Peninsula take from our empire 100 million sesterces every year. That's the sum which our luxuries and our women cost us. For what fraction of these imports, I ask you, now goes to the gods or to the powers of the lower world? It's a typical Roman formulation. Blame the foreigner, blame the woman. The enormous value of the silk monopoly was recognized at both ends of the route. According to Procopius, two Western monks returning from China smuggled out silkworms in their staffs around 550 AD and brought them back to the court of Justinian, who was then able to start silk production in Byzantium. And a popular folktale from China tells the same story. This is the story of the Silk Princess. The princess, going to the king of Khotan, was asked to bring three items: mulberry seeds, silkworm eggs, and technicians skilled in producing silk cloth. If she brought these, this would be her dowry. That's how valuable it was. Just let us steal some of your technology. She would not have to bring gold, silver, gems, and pearls as well. In leaving China, the princess concealed the silkworms in her headdress. You can actually see them kind of swirling around in her hair, which is frankly pretty disgusting. Also, one of her female servants hid the mulberry seeds among herbs in a medicine chest. When the princess reached Khotan, its minister asked her why no male technician who knew the art of silk making had come with her. She told him that she had indeed brought three excellent technicians. They were her maidservants, skilled in planting mulberry trees, breeding and raising silkworms, and also in weaving. In China, she explained, these skills are considered to be women's work and learned by all young girls. And as in today, in most Asian countries, such as in this shot from North Korea, if any of you have been to Turkey and been to rug factories and you've seen silk being produced for weaving, it's always women's work. All right, so far I've been sketching a picture of a network that spanned four empires and allowed for the movement of goods as well as ideas from East Asia to the Mediterranean. But I've also tried to distinguish so far between this developed network, the Roman and the Chinese imperial periods, and the less organized, less systematic trade of earlier times. So the question I want to pose for you now is, how and why did the Silk Route emerge as a developed network? And here we turn to Alexander's role in East Asia. We need to backtrack a little bit. Alexander, as you know, inherited the throne of Macedon from his father Philip in 336 BC. Suppressing revolts in Greece and on Macedon's borders, Alexander continued with his father's plans of uniting the Greeks by leading them on an expedition against the Persian Empire, normally to avenge the Persian invasion of Greece that had taken place 150 years earlier. From 334 to 324, Alexander led his army of Greeks and Macedonians on a wild campaign that took him down the Mediterranean coast to Egypt as far as Siwa, where he was greeted as the son of Zeus Amon, and then he proceeded into the heartland of Persia. Along the way, he defeated the king's satraps at the Battle of the Granicus, and then he defeated the great king himself twice at the Battle of Issus and at the Battle of Gaugamela. There's some debate as to whether this mosaic depicts the second or the third of the great battles. It doesn't really matter. Now, upon his entry to Babylon, he had forced the Persian king Darius III to flee ignominiously. He'd captured the oldest and wealthiest city in the Persian Empire, had captured the great king's mother and wife, had proved himself superior in every way to a man who was treated as a semi-divine authority, the representative of Ahura Mazda on earth. One might think that if the aim of his expedition was to punish the Persians, he had succeeded. And if one prefers to imagine him as some ancient imperialist eager for territory, one might note that he'd expanded the territory inhabited and ruled by the Greeks at least tenfold. Mission accomplished. Yet he didn't stop. And the second phase of his conquests produced an itinerary that has puzzled scholars ever since. See if I can find a title. Good. So, here's little Greece, here's Macedon. The Battle of the Granicus fought here, then the Battle of Issus fought here, he comes down into Egypt, goes out to Amon where he's greeted as the son of God, comes back and up across the Fertile Crescent, into Iraq, and at Erbil he fights the Battle of Gaugamela, Arbela, as it used to be called. And you would think then that he could finish. I mean, once he's down here in Babylon, he's captured this entire empire and driven the Persian king out. But he continues in phase two into this area, modern-day Iran. Fergus Miller, a very fine historian, wrote not long ago, there followed in phase two Alexander's still almost entirely unintelligible expedition across Iran and Central Asia to present-day Afghanistan and Tajikistan, before turning south to the Indus Valley, and home again, by way of a grueling march along the northern shores of the Indian Ocean and the eastern shores of the Persian Gulf. What was Alexander doing in Central Asia, in the so-called Upper Satrapies? Plutarch saw it as a mission to civilize the natives. He said quite simply, if you examine the results of Alexander's instruction, you'll see that he educated the Hyrcanians to respect the marriage bond, taught the Arachosians to till the soil, persuaded the Sogdians to support their parents, not to kill them, and the Persians to respect their mothers and not to marry them. When Alexander was civilizing Asia, Homer was commonly read, and the children of the Persians and of the Susianians and the Gadrosians learned to chant the tragedies of Sophocles and Euripides. Thus, Alexander's new subjects would not have been civilized had they not been vanquished. Egypt would not have had its Alexandria, nor Mesopotamia its Seleucia, nor Sogdiana its Prophthasia, nor India Bucephalia, nor the Caucasus, the Hindu Kush, a Greek city near it. All right, classic statement of a civilizing mission. Another interpretation, which seems to go back to Alexander's official history, generated while he was actually on the march, was that he was subject to pothos, yearning, divinely inspired drive that took him ever further in search of adventure, desiring to outdo Dionysus, who in some versions had come to Greece from India, and Heracles, his ancestor. Well, if correct, pothos may explain some of Alexander's psychology, but personally I'm a little dubious about putting a man onto the couch 2,500 years after his death. A Freudian reading of Alexander, for me, is the stuff of fiction, not of history. Apologies to all Freudians. What we can say is that there is at least a plausible reason, historically, for his continued movement east, and that was his pursuit of Darius, and then of Darius's killer, Bessus, who briefly assumes the throne of Persia. Alexander's march of the so-called Upper Satrapies, corresponding to today's Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Afghanistan, was initially prompted by a fierce desire to assert his legitimacy by capturing and punishing the usurper Bessus. But Once he entered these regions of Central Asia, he found a world of tantalizing contrasts. Fertile regions with high mountain pastures and plains were occupied for the most part by nomads, who notoriously were seen in the Greek world as backwards and uncivilized. At the same time, spices, silk, precious stones, all the stuff I showed you in the earlier slides, all entered the region from further east. So there was an incentive to make the region Greek, to bring it into the orbit of Alexander's empire. And here Alexander made a fateful decision, a decision not to cross the Hindu Kush and to enter Western China, but instead to garrison the eastern edge of his empire with a string of cities, all called, humbly, Alexandria, making it Greek territory. Of course, the popular story is that Alexander wept when he realized there were no more worlds to conquer. That's actually ludicrous. A version of that story occurred in 2012 in the New Yorker, and it really points to the very silliness of that story. So it's utterly irrelevant to this legend, but I have to share it with you. Alexander smashed every army sent against him, slaughtering thousands. Those who fled the battlefields were hunted down and killed. Men and women and children were sold into slavery, but the happy times couldn't last. Eventually, there were no more people left to conquer. What about the Assyrians? Alexander asked his general. We conquered them, one of them replied. Okay, how about the Bactrians? Conquered, several general said, sing song. Alexander was getting desperate. What if we gave countries their freedom, then conquered them again? The generals looked down at their feet. One The idea that he wept because there was nothing left to conquer is a bit of nonsense flatly contradicted by the ancient sources. In fact, thanks to Arrian's account, we know exactly when and why Alexander turned back. It was when Alexander in northern India, having defeated Porus, the Indian prince, expected to cross the Indus and to continue his campaigns, only to be stopped by his men, who implored him to let them to return to Macedonia and to enjoy the fruits of their conquest. Please, we've been marching for 10 years. Can we go home and enjoy our booty? Alexander wept all right. He wept because there was India to conquer, a region the Greeks quickly realized that was as old and as venerable as their own culture. It actually caught the imagination of the authors of the Alexander Romance. And you have a lovely version of it with Alexander looking very much like an early Habsburg emperor, meeting the gymnosophists, the lady gymnosophists, and the baby gymnosophists. That's quite charming. So Alexander was prepared, he was prepared, emphatically, to go further east. He was only stopped by his own men's fatigue. And yet, here's the kicker, and this is what historians have never paid, in my opinion, enough attention to. He had already turned back from the Hindu Kush and from the approaches to Xinjiang, Western China. He's already made a tactical move. Now, since we know that Alexander was prepared to keep advancing east, the question surely is, why had he retreated from the Pamir Mountains? Well, I think a basic cost-benefit analysis was sufficient. It's one thing for a small band of individuals to cross high mountains, but to take an army across here was another matter altogether. Now, there is a corridor, the Irakshtam Pass, that leads from Afghanistan to China. But committing to this would require a very concrete benefit. If you're going to take 10,000 Greeks through there, you better have a good reason, a very good reason. What was on the other side? Alexander saw glory by defeating foes in battle. After Darius, he was pleased to find princes with armies worth fighting in pitched battles like Taxiles in Pakistan and Porus at the border with India. But in these mountains, all he encountered were nomad chieftains. And these he pacified as his father had done. He bribed them with gifts and he married their daughters. This is where he married Roxanne. It's the region she comes from. And had he crossed into Western China to Xinjiang, he would have encountered the Taklamakan Desert. And beyond that, warring states further to the east and more nomads occupying a territory that offered little reward for annexation. So what Alexander chose to do, clearly, was to annex the territory on the western side of the Pamir Mountains and the Hindu Kush. Concentrating his attention here, he left garrisons of Macedonian and Greek veterans. Now, Alexander had a reputation of founding over 70 cities, but many of these are little more than pre-existing settlements to which he gave his name. One might expect that his entire conquered territory would contain Alexander's, but in fact, the tactical disposition of these and those of his successors hints at a very deliberate policy. Where did Alexander leave Alexandria's? Many cities were located by the Mediterranean, suggesting the pull of the ancestral homeland of the Greeks and the Macedonians. But in Bactria and in Sogdia, in Afghanistan and northeastern Iran, Alexander established cities that would really resemble the colonial outposts of more modern times. And with his particular focus on the upper satrapies, so far from Greece and Macedon, it suggests to me that Alexander was looking to control the wealth of the region and to encourage the trade that originated from here and the trade that passed through here. In effect, Alexander established a series of sites that served the trade network into and out of China. And by doing so, Alexander the Great made possible the emergence of the Silk Route as a fully developed, integrated trade network. Some of these cities we know of by the name of Alexandria, Alexandria in the Caucasus, Alexandria Escate, but the best and the best known and the best excavated is Khanum, possibly Alexandria on the Oxus, but in fact we actually don't know for certain its ancient name. Nestled between mountains and the bend in the river, the city, as you can see, was well fortified, laid out rationally, and it boasted major civic architecture and a royal palace. Here Alexander and his successors created a pocket of Hellenism on the edge of the Hindu Kush. As you can see here, there are long walls defending it, towers, a Greek-style theater, Greco-Bactrian architecture, a gymnasium with dedications to Hermes and Heracles. This is in Afghanistan, not close to Greece, in case your geography is not so good. Various temples here and mosaics, particularly with the Macedonian sunburst. The gymnasium here had the maxims of Delphi inscribed over the entrance, and even copies of texts had been found here showing what young men read at the gymnasium as they got their education. And what they read in Khanum was Aristotle, the man who was the tutor of Alexander the Great. These buildings, especially the theatre, are as evocative of Greek culture as a cricket ground in Pakistan. A dramatic statement of the colonial presence. In recent times, the British, in ancient times, the Greeks. This is a reconstruction of the theatre, half excavated. Aeschylus and Sophocles, the stuff of our classical curriculum that we associate with the Greeks, they were being read and performed here in Afghanistan. It's quite extraordinary. Houses decorated with symbols that could come straight out of Pella, and not Pella in Jordan, but Pella in Macedon. Public buildings like stolas, previously unknown in this part of the world. Decorative motifs like these Corinthian capitals found thousands of miles from the places that originally spawned them. And what were the people thinking who felt the need to recreate Delphi on the Amu Darya River in northern Afghanistan? As you go into the gymnasium there, you read the same thing you read at Delphi. As children learn good manners, as young men learn to control the passions, and so forth. And this is the actual text of Aristotle found in Afghanistan. This would be like in 1920 reading Shakespeare in Peshawar in Pakistan. Since the 1970s, the major vector of investigation has been to ask in what ways this settlement represents an outpost of Hellenism. But from the point of view of understanding the economic policies of the Seleucids, who ruled after Alexander in this area, the evidence from the treasury here found by the palace is even more interesting. In these rooms were stored grain and oil paid as tax in kind to the Greek rulers. But in addition, we have also records of vessels like this one, with carefully written documents and accounts on the outside, showing the number of silver drachmas stored in them, often amounting to over 500 drachmas, as well as recording evidence of punch-marked coins called kasapana in Greek, a direct translation of the Indian term kasharpana. There's a fusion going on of the two cultures. Coins whose veracity was being established in what is in essence a bank, a center of monetary exchange for Greeks and non-Greeks. These coins shown, these collections of coins, often shown with the AM ligature, as you can see on that side, frequently record amounts of over 10,000 coins. This is not tax collected in kind, of oil or grain. It's the result of the control of luxury trade in others being taxed as they pass along the caravan routes. And in some cases, we even know what the goods are because we've got vessels inscribed here, Libanotu, the Greek word meaning Libanotos, meaning frankincense. So this is a jar of precious spices. This is the material that gave Alexander's successors, the Seleucids, such an estimable source of wealth above and beyond the staples used to feed armies and people, and which could be used to establish revenues. For a brief period after Alexander, his successors would in fact attempt to create a region under their control extending into Western China. And there is dramatic evidence of this, of their presence as far as Urumqi in northwestern China, although political and military control was short-lived. But nevertheless, this textile shows you what is usually identified as a Greek soldier, perhaps a mercenary, living on the Chinese side of the Pamir Mountains, the bridgehead of the Greek advance. And another textile there shows you, my favorite creature, the centaur. Another Greek motif turning up in a Chinese context. But the Greeks in these far reaches of Alexander's empire, sent there to secure the region and to control trade for their superiors further west, were unwilling settlers for the most part. And after Alexander's death, there were uprisings among the veterans who wished to come home. Other settlers came out from Greece, but the Greek political domination of the region was tenuous. Early on, for example, in his reign, Seleucus, one of Alexander's successors, actually ceded everything at the far eastern end of his empire to Chandragupta, founder of the Mauryan Empire. And so that area of Afghanistan and Pakistan was ceded to the Mauryans in return for receiving 500 pans of tanks. Known in antiquity as elephants. Now here the story starts to get a little interesting, and here's where I want to shake a few trees. The Seleucid realm, established by Alexander's successors to control all of Central Asia, declined in terms of total territory controlled over the next two centuries, and it is usually seen as a mark of the kingdom's weakness. Now, you can chart this very simply by just doing the math. Look at the territory they control over this period and add up how much is there. In 301 BC, the Seleucids controlled 3 million square kilometers. In 240 BC, a little over 2.5 million square kilometers. By 175 BC, under a million square kilometers, and by 100 BC, only about 100,000 square kilometers. So this is part of a narrative of decline measured by territory controlled. But what about if we apply a Silk Route strategy and see these empires as less interested in territory and more in the revenues created by a trade network? We can compare this shot of the empire seen in the same terms as we used to have the good old British Empire, where it's a different color on the map. And you can see in a later period, it's much truncated. Here the presence of many other units visually connotes a dramatic loss of territory. And this has been the dominant narrative of Seleucid history. As recently as 2013, two ancient historians could write, "Loss of territory and thus resources and manpower diminished political clout in the face of Roman interference, and the Seleucid dynasty's apparent slide into dissolute luxury all make their impression upon the historian." Can you tell me that in 2015 we're still relying on morality as the benchmark for understanding the ancient world, those dissolute Seleucids? Surely we can do better. At a time when numerous empires flourished, what need was there to undertake the expensive business of controlling vast areas of territory when it was all relatively unproductive land? When instead you could concentrate on key nodes within a flourishing trade network. The key to real wealth in this world lies not in oil, wine, grain, or other agricultural staples, but in the controlling and taxing of the flow of luxury goods. Hence, they told him he's interested in Berenike in the Red Sea, and the Seleucid interest in Palmyra and Dorylaeus, the sites where the caravans emerged from the desert. This is an important point, I think. I don't deny that eventually the Seleucids fell into internal dissent and external pressure, but the steady drumbeat of decline is overdone. Marquis Apergis, a very fine historian, has recently observed of the Seleucid economy. Some royal revenues were collected in silver, but most were probably received in kind. On the other hand, the military and other payments envisaged for the future were likely to be overwhelmingly in silver. Consequently, a significant imbalance existed, or would shortly exist, regarding precious metal, which would impose a serious drain on the treasury. Therefore, it was necessary to devise some method for permanently halting the drain of silver and ensuring that the treasury always had an adequate supply for its needs. Apergis has argued that the Seleucid royal economy was rich in taxable produce and hence revenue, but poor in silver. I suggest that the desperate need of Hellenistic kings after Alexander to pay for their endless wars wrought a transformation in the trade and economic policies that they fostered. The Silk Route, as a developed systematic network of nodes and links connecting Asia and Europe, was, if I'm correct, a creation of the Greek empires of Central Asia. What happened to the Greek kingdoms in Central Asia? Left to their own devices, the Greek states of Bactria, ruled by Greeks who took the title of king, were gradually cut off from the Greek West, and then something magical happened, a true fusion of Greek and Indian culture, a true Silk Route hybrid in the culture of Gandhara, in northwestern India and Pakistan. Chandragupta's grandson, the great Ashoka, sent his ambassadors forth even as far as the Mediterranean to preach the Buddhist gospel. And I'm ashamed of the number of Western historians that are utterly unaware of this incredible material. Here's Ashoka the Great saying that the conquest by Dharma, justice, has been won here on the borders and even 600 Yoyanas, 4,000 miles away, where the Greek king Antiochus rules. Beyond there, where the four kings named Ptolemy, Antigonus, Magas, the king of Cyrene, and Alexander rule. Likewise, in the south, among the Cholas, the Pandyas, and as far away as Taprobana, which is his term for Sri Lanka. Until eventually, this Buddhist culture from northwestern India fused with the remaining Greeks living in the Hindu Kush. And this fusion, which only lasts for a couple of hundred years, is, I think, quite magical and should be recognized. It's best encapsulated by this figure, a Greek king by the name of Menander, the same name as the 4th century playwright. And you can see the coin on the left shows the Greek king wearing the fillet, showing that he's a king, and around the coin, around his portrait, is the legend Basileios Dikaiou Menandrou, meaning a coin of King Menander the Just. And on the other side of the same coin, these aren't two coins, they're two sides of the same coin, lies his portrait, and in Prakrit is written, in Kharoshthi, excuse me, is written Maharajasa, great king, Dharmakasa, with Dharma, with justice, Menadrasa. It's a perfect fusion of the Indian Buddhist and the Greek. Menander converted to Buddhism. He issued coins that were bilingual, but spoke of one commitment to justice, Dike in Greek, Dharma in Sanskrit. And in Buddhist writings, he's remembered not by his Greek name Menander, but by his Prakrit name Melinda. And one of the sutras of the Buddhist texts is Melinda's sutra. These cultures spoke to each other because so many of their key ethical and spiritual notions were similar. Is Olympian Khan, Apollo at Olympia, Temple of Zeus, 460 BC, very different from achieving Nirvana, Buddha's head, from Gandhara, 1st and 2nd century AD? And it is in the age of Alexander and his successors that Ataraxia, imperturbability, becomes the goal of Greek philosophers. The gods, for people like Lucretius, are detached and live in tranquility
as we're supposed to do, in exactly the same way as the Buddha lives calm and detached. So although Alexander's political domination of the region was short-lived, the cultural fusion that occurred in the centuries after him was perhaps the most fitting testimony to his impact on the creation of a Silk Route that mingled cultures across thousands of miles. Here is a blue-eyed, bearded Westerner, a Buddhist monk, standing next to his clean-shaven Eastern brother monk. Fitting then that this quick sidebar to the kingdom of Gandhara should focus on a pair of images that speak eloquently to the belief that we have much more in common than that which separates us. More broadly, I'm suggesting then that there are different imperial narratives at work in our treatment of the Silk Route. The dominant story is of a network hard to control and manipulated by competing imperial states from China to Rome. But beneath that lies a more interesting story of an attempt first by Alexander and then by his successors, the Seleucids, to redefine empire. In place of a purely territorial definition in which tribute supplies the royal coffers with produce, under Alexander and the Seleucid successors, we see the first move towards a non-territorial control of resources, luxury, high-value items, which in their passage across territory supplied new opportunities for cash-strapped imperial states to raise revenue. By opening up new avenues for trade, Alexander left his imprint on history, and it resulted in a new way of visualizing Buddha, then that simply shows how unpredictable are the paths of history. Thank you.
I think that Jeremy would be happy to take some questions.
Absolutely, sure. I'm not keeping an eye on the time, so I'm going to leave that to you guys.
Okay.
So in the decline of the Seleucids, patterns or locations of warfare, the places of battle, the places they really defend and so forth, does that fit the network?
Yes, what happens is that the contraction of their territory shows that they're concentrating on what is considered a kind of Seleucid heartland, which is what today we would call Syria. And the important places there are located on the Mediterranean coast, where of course the trade will go out to the Med, but then also the headwaters of the Tigris and the Euphrates, at places like Palmyra and Dura Europus, where Seleucid control means that even though you've given up, I mean, honestly, graphically, if the Seleucid Empire at its farthest extent is from this lectern to that wall, by the first century, they've given up all of that. But everything that's crossing through Central Asia ends up being funneled to the top of the Fertile Crescent. And as long as you control that territory, as far as the Mediterranean coast, Palmyra, Dura Europus, Antioch, Seleucia, you've got actual control of the key node that takes you from Central Asia to the Mediterranean. And so their warfare and what they choose to defend and to give up actually corresponds to that. I think they give up massive amounts of territory, but to not much effect in terms of imperial revenues. I think that actually does work, yeah.
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 Is much known about the traders, where they were from, so they didn't go long distance?
There's not a lot of really good evidence about that. The fact that Greek is being used in places like Khanum is very interesting because, you know, these are records serving whoever's taking hold of that stuff. That's often seen as an indication of these being officers in a Seleucid bureaucracy recording materials. As for the traders themselves, we don't really have a very clear idea, but you know, the presence of some of these images of Westerners across in Western China does mean there's definitely some movement going through, but I couldn't be more specific than that, I'm sorry. I wish we knew, but we don't really.
Yeah,
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. You lay out a really interesting account of the ways in which a connection or a sort of synthesis between Buddhism and Greek culture happens at the height of about 150 BC later. Are there earlier connections, is Alexander the first to really carve these connections out? I'm thinking about like with your identification of PK with Dharma.
Right.
Now, are there ways in which Anaximander's use of PK is reminiscent of Dharma? Are there earlier connections, and what's the material history there?
Those are two very full questions. The first answer is there are many people who believe that the connections do go back to the 5th century. And it's based largely on observed similarities between philosophical texts. The material connection cannot be attested. In other words, I can't show you the kinds of objects for 400 BC that I can show you for 150 BC. And so, you know, the movement of ideas between regions is so difficult to pin down because, I mean, all of Hesiod's poetry is reflecting Near Eastern contacts, and that's taking us back to 700 BC. So ideas move because people tell stories, and philosophies move. I mean, Thales is probably influenced by things like Babylonian astronomy. You know, his ability to predict an eclipse. Yeah, thank you. Is probably based on familiarity with Babylonian records that have been so complete that they're able to predict these eclipses. But in terms of the material contact that you're asking for, I can't give you that before you get Alexander and his successors actually dominating the area and then establishing essentially colonial outposts. Sorry.
Well, my question was similar to James's, but are there other evidence or other than just the religious one, are there other?
Yeah, I didn't present tonight, but there are some extensive descriptions in the Roman geographer Strabo, who gives you really quite detailed accounts of some of the cities located up in the Hindu Kush. And they're really quite extraordinary because he makes them look like the Garden of Eden. I mean, these are descriptions that sound like, you know, like places like Toledo in the 14th century where Jews and Muslims and Christians are actually getting on and living side by side quite happily. His version of the cities of the Hindu Kush is that it didn't matter whether you were Chinese or whether you were Indian or Greek, what your religion was, what your background was, everything was ruled by justice. You know, they sound like the Neil Young song where the women were all beautiful and the men stood straight and tall. It's almost too good to be true. But, you know, the fact that stuff was all wiped out around 200 AD means that it just sort of put an end to it. And what I'm fascinated by is that there are these little sort of cultural moments of fusion, a beautiful culture even at a time when politically it's almost doomed. It can't survive the growth of nomadic invasions, for example, in that period. But yes, there are. Strabo's particularly good on this. Yeah.
Obviously places like the Ring of Alexandria's that you were showing along the eastern edge are, you know, those places I still see a lot of conflict. And so how does that influence what gets excavated and how it...
At the moment, it's a question of what is destroyed and what's, you know, saved
and what questions have gotten asked by who controls the narrative?
Yeah, well, the narrative is fractured, quite frankly. You know, some of Khanum was, for a period, badly under attack from the Northern Alliance, who were our allies. And then later, a very large U.S. Air Force base was very close to the area. A lot of it has been destroyed right now. There is no active excavation going on there, certainly by the old French team that was there in the 70s. And these are places where it's simply too dangerous for foreign archaeologists to be doing much work. There is now more work being done in the slightly more stable Central Asian republics, the former Soviet republics. Places like Tajikistan, but there is often a sort of a national narrative. They're under-resourced, and their attitude towards foreign archaeologists often varies from day to day, depending upon how good your language skills are, what sort of connections you've made, whether you cooperate with the local authorities, what have you. So it's actually in a period of real turmoil right now. I don't think there is a single archaeological narrative. It varies from place to place, really dramatically. Yeah?
You've alluded to this, but what shuts this down? Is that around 200 AD?
Invasion from nomadic tribes from Western China. In the Greek sources, they're called the Sakai. And as best as we know, they're just nomadic groups that pour through from Western China and obliterate most of these cities, at least for a period until they're sort of resuscitated hundreds of years later. But this fusion of particularly Greek culture and Buddhist culture does not survive.
Does it shut down the trade as well?
The trade continues at fluctuating levels through late antiquity. And things like the creation of a silk industry in Byzantium certainly has an effect, because one of the major items is no longer, you know, controlled. Also, some of the kingdoms in between, like Parthia and Khotan, undergo various dynastic changes, warfare between them. I think Steve knows this better than I do. But there's a lot of political and military turmoil in the area. But what specifically cuts off what I've been showing you is a set of invasions. There's no doubt about that. Yeah?
So I'm curious as to why neither empire was very concerned with knowing much about the other one. Instead, the information from Rome, they only extend to Afghanistan, and China only extends to Afghanistan.
Yeah.
So do we have any evidence that they saw themselves as actually trading with an empire that far away?
Yeah.
Or was it more they're trading with like the provinces in between?
Yeah, that's a really good question. They are aware in either case that there is something big at the either end. And they have a label for this in both cases. They're also aware that in practical terms, they're actually dealing with middlemen. And the role of the middlemen there, it still needs to be teased out. But there's even a theory that's been suggested, and I don't think it's well supported, but a theory that the silk cloth being sent from Western China, once it reached somewhere intermediate, either as far as Antioch or possibly a little further east in the Parthian kingdom, is actually being unwoven and turned back into spooled thread. And that's being sent on because it's really easy to transport it, and then you can charge even more for it to be rewoven at the Mediterranean. So that those intermediate states are really quite powerful. It's a real barrier between them. Your deeper question is also a very good one, and that is, why are they not more interested, in a sense, just in the pure geographic knowledge? And the answer I'd offer for that is that a lot of work done now on the Roman side, and I can't speak for the Chinese side, but on the Roman side, actually argues that geographic knowledge is a kind of outgrowth of imperial power. And that if you know an area, and if you bring material from that area into your center, you're actually demonstrating that you have control over it. It's sort of the theory that lies behind the great fairs being held in France, world fairs and things like that. You sort of brought in, you know, creatures from Africa or creatures from India, and often tribes people for that matter as well, to say, this is the world that we control. Well, the Romans don't control that far eastern world. So in a sense, by saying, well, you know, we don't really know what's going on there, you're kind of leaving that as a closed book. I think you're going to weigh in on that.
I'm just going to suggest that the lack of knowledge at either end that early is also a sign of the tenuousness, the early but incomplete formalization of the entire route, and then its interruption in 200.
Yeah.
Because you can then trace when things are really firmly re-established after the growth of the caliphate.
Yeah.
You can trace networks generate knowledge.
Among
others.
Yeah, yeah.
You can trace the growth of geographic knowledge from about 800 to 1400 very clearly in a series of maps that are produced in all along the route from Korea all the way to Spain.
Right. Right.
So I think it's partly a sign of the strength of the network itself.
The one thing that fits both of what we're saying is that the one area that the Romans do show a more precise geographic interest is in the Red Sea trade and the monsoon trade to India. And once they become aware of those winds and start to realize that seasonally you can send ships in one direction and then send them back, then they start to write about that in their geographic writings. So that area does get it. The land route doesn't. Joe?
That was
That's part of my question. Okay. Right to that. Why didn't the sea route just supplant the land route? I mean, it seems to me it's longer, but so much easier, at least during certain times of the year. Mm. I don't quite understand the relationship between the sea route.
I don't think that's actually being fully teased out, to tell the truth, but I think some of the material is coming from sufficiently north that to get to the sea route would mean, you know, a long land route anyway.
At this period, you would get from China to Rome via the sea route anyway, because southern China is not even under imperial control until significantly later, until the later Han.
And to say to get that stuff, for example, to India, and to get access to the Indian Ocean route, you still get across mountains and the Deccan.
Or go through the Straits of Malacca, which is pretty hairy. Yeah. and the South China Sea is also kind of difficult until they get better ship technology. Mm-hmm.
Any more questions?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's not so much a question to that, but the other thing to consider is that they're not, you know, it's not one person carrying one good all the way from Eastern China to Western Rome. They hand it off in between, so it's really more of a handoff. If any one person has to only bring it to their neighbor, then it's easier for any one person.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Yeah.
So it's as a mathematician, the physics disposition in analogy, sort of like a Tesla's alternating current versus Edison's DC current.
You know, it's remarkable you say that, because I was just going to say that analogy. Unfortunately, since I have no idea what it means.
I think on that note.